Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is Todd Wilkins' guest on Issues, Etc., where they discussed California's directive requiring insurers to cover elective abortions and a partial lift on Utah's polygamy ban.
Joining us to talk about a federal judge is striking down part of Utah's polygamy ban and California insurers being told by the California Department of Managed Health Care that they must cover elective abortion. Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founding president of the Ruth Institute, based in San Marcos, California. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason universities, and she is author of the book Smart Sex and Love in Economics. Jennifer, welcome back.
Hi, Todd. Glad to be back with you.
I wanted to ask you about the California issue first. This is from the California Departments of Managed Care Department Director Michelle Ruillard. She said that abortion is a basic health care service. She says it's encompassed by the language of a law in 1975 that requires insurance companies to cover all medically necessary care. And she says all health plans must treat maternity services and legal abortion neutrally. What's going on here, and what's your reaction?
Well, this is a reaction. This is kind of a cleanup operation to an earlier ruling that appeared to leave some wiggle room for faith-based organizations to not cover abortion. But the fact is, Todd, I'm afraid that California has long had some of the most rigid ideological pro-abortion regulations that require everybody to cover things. So it's not really a surprise that they're doing this. They've also had a kind of contraceptive mandate in place for a long time. So, you know, in many respects, the California law is more binding and more biting for religious employers than the federal law is. So, you know, not good news, but not entirely surprising news either.
So, in other words, pro-lifers are simply put in the position of having to find health care coverage that meets with their conscience. Is that possible, to find health care coverage that meets with your conscience on the abortion issue in California?
Do you know what, Todd? I don't want to answer you with a straight-up yes-no on that question because I could be wrong. But my sense of the matter is that it's not possible to do so. And if somebody, you know, so let me state that as clearly as I can. My sense is that it's not possible in the state of California to obtain health insurance that does not include abortion and contraception coverage. I think that's the case. If that's not the case, I hope someone from California or somebody who knows otherwise will let me know, you know, if there is some way that a religious school or, in this case, universities, there's a couple of Jesuit-run universities that we're trying to straighten out their health plan so that they would be in accordance with Catholic teaching. If anybody knows of a way that a religious employer can be exempt from either abortion or contraceptive coverage in the state of California, please let me know. But it's my sense that it's not possible, that that kind of coverage doesn't exist.
Okay, this is an interesting story here, kind of an ongoing story since 2011, I believe. Some a polygamist is taking legal action to try and get Utah's polygamy statute knocked down, at least part of it. And a federal judge, Clark Wadups, in December did strike down a section of the Utah's bigamy statute that is applied to people when they live together, multiple partners when they live together, with people to whom they are not legally married. What has happened here? Is this kind of yet another one of the inching forwards of polygamy along with the other redefinitions of marriage?
Do you know what? When I read this story, I wasn't quite sure what was going on, what's new in this story as opposed to what happened in December. So I think the real action took place in December, where they basically said it's unconstitutional the flat-out polygamy ban is somehow unconstitutional. It's a bigamy statute that says if your wife is living, you can't go have another wife. But these people weren't trying to get marriage licenses, okay? So if you show up and you want a second marriage license, the state won't give it to you. What these people are doing is holding themselves out as married. They weren't trying to go get another marriage license. And so the question is, will the state prosecute them? And what the state of Utah was saying is because these guys are in flagrant violation of the law, they have a TV program talking about it. At one point, an official of the state of Utah said, you know what, you guys, this is against the law, what you're doing there on your reality TV show. You know, we could do something about it. Well, that was enough to trigger these people going to court to say, protect us from this dastardly thing that might happen from the state of Utah. And my sense of it is that the state of Utah has no intention of going around enforcing this statute unless there's some other crime involved. So if one of the girls is underage or there's child abuse or something like that is going on, then they enforce it. But there are undoubtedly other cases of polygamy going on in various Western states, not just Utah, where the statutes aren't being enforced. That's undoubtedly the case. And so if you're responsible for law enforcement in your state, what are you going to do about that? And the people have kind of made a judgment, well, we're not going to do too much about it. But if you're right in our face with it, what are they supposed to do? So now what's happened here is that, a kind of high visibility academic lawyer has taken this case and is trying to draw attention to it, and they're treating it like a freedom to marry type case. They're treating it like an anti-discrimination case, and hoping that that style of rhetoric will allow a full-on permission with no possibility that the state's going to enforce the law against you, but just simply a removal, eventual removal of the law on this matter. I think that's what they're hoping for. And so what happened here, I think, is just a little frosting on the cake, and it remains to be seen whether the state of Utah will appeal what just took place. And that will be the real interesting question.
So we're talking here about, to put it in kind of simple terms, a guy who's married to one of these women, and then he's pretending to be married to the other three. Has a television program, but technically under Utah statute, he would have been considered it wouldn't be a bigamist in this case. It would be a polygamist in this case. Does it surprise you, Jennifer, that the 2011 lawsuit that they brought was arguing that Utah's law violated their right to privacy and based their arguments largely upon the Supreme Court decision back in 2003 that struck down a Texas law against sodomy?
Well, they're also now they're making noises about religious freedom. You know, they're saying that because our religion says it's okay, then it's okay. You have to let us do it. So a lot of the arguments that people are trying to make are getting stood on their heads here. You know, this development does not surprise me, because what we're having here, Todd, is the whole deconstruction of any structural system surrounding sexual behavior. That's really what's happening. So one man, one woman for life is a pretty strict structure, but it's a structure that does some very important jobs for society. So since people think that's too onerous to have that structure, they're going about removing every kind of structure that they're finding using the same kind of statute. So not only is it not, it doesn't have to be life for life, it doesn't have to be a man or a woman, and now it doesn't have to be one of each. It can be as many people as you really want. And what no one is thinking about, Todd, as far as I can tell, nobody's thinking about the long-term structural implications of allowing multiple partner marriage like this. Nobody's thinking about that. So in societies that allow polygamy, there's some very consistent patterns that one sees, and the very most important one is that rich men hog all the women to themselves. That's the most important thing. And so then there are men who have no wives. And what happens to those men? How do they behave? What are the secondary effects? What are the trickle-down effects that take place? This is not a structural system that serves the interests of women, because now rich men have a kind of rights to women that don't exist in a strictly monogamous system. And so nobody's asking the question, what's going to happen if we, in a wholesale way, remove the one man, one woman, the two-ness of marriage? What's going to happen? What's that society going to look like? Nobody wants to talk about that. Jonathan Turley, the attorney for these polygamists, Jonathan Turley certainly doesn't want to talk about that.
Two quick final questions. You said earlier that no one in this case is actually asking for a second or a third, or in this case, he's got one, two, I'm trying to count the women.
He's got four.
He's got four wives. Four, one. Yeah. So no one's asking for three extra marriage licenses, but we kind of know the way these things go. Would you be surprised if in a short course of time there isn't some sort of lawsuit attempting to get extra marriage licenses awarded to men who obviously he feels like he can do this. Cody Brown, if he wants another wife, another marriage license, about 30 seconds.
I don't know. Why don't they give out one license and three learner's permits? I don't know. Yes, I think you're probably right. Eventually, that's what it will come to.
Finally, speaking of Utah, you actually are going to be speaking at the Stand for Family Conference next month in Provo. Tell us a little bit about the conference.
Yes, I'm very excited about this conference. Mostly women in the Salt Lake City area are putting together a conference called Stand for the Family, and there will be a rally on Thursday, September 18th, and then there will be a full-day conference in Provo on Friday the 19th, and I'll be there speaking. The Ruth Institute is one of the co-hosts of this conference. We're very proud to be partnering with our friends in Utah. They have made a great effort. You know, Utah has a reputation as being a Mormon stronghold, which is true. It is a Mormon stronghold. But they want participation of all religious denominations and religious traditions to be part of what they're doing there. So they were very particular to reach out to the Ruth Institute in the hopes that we would bring some of our Catholic friends along, and I'm hoping to bring some of our Lutheran friends along. If you guys listen to what's happening here and people want to come and be part of it, by all means, everyone is welcome to come and be part of it. And if you're not able to come, you can certainly support the Ruth Institute as we go to support our expenses, or you can just promote the conference, tell your friends about it. If you go to the Ruth Institute Facebook page, pinned to the very top of our Facebook page, we have a little notice about the conference so that you can easily share that with any friends that you might have that would benefit from coming. Because there'll be a lot of important information about the institution of marriage. We're really going to try to deal with these deeper issues that get brushed aside in the political and legal sphere so often today.
Folks, you can find out more about the Stand for the Family Conference September the 18th and 19th in Provo, Utah at our website, issuesetc.org. Click Listen on Demand. Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse is founding president of the Ruth Institute based in San Marcos, California. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason Universities, and she is author of the books Smart Sex and Love and Economics. Jennifer, thanks for your time.
You're very welcome.
You've just been listening to Dr. J and Todd Wilkin discussing California's elective abortion mandate and Utah's crumbling polygamy ban. Check out more of Todd's interviews over at the on-demand archives at issuesetc.org. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.